18, believe it or not, we still are not with 100% certainty understanding why some implants begin to break down 5 years, 8 years, 10 years after the fact. We have some theories, and we have some good ideas in terms of how to go about managing it, but with respect to all of the potential factors, in 2017, and I'll talk about it a little bit later, there was a consensus conference that looked at the difference changes to the looked at the difference changes to the periodontal diagnostic categories, and they also included a section on defining and diagnosing peri-implantitis. And even in 2017, 2018, there are still a lot of questions that are unanswered. And even the articles that I'm going to give you today or show you were articles that were mentioned in this particular outline. And some of these articles date back to the late 1990s. And some of these articles date back to the late 1990s, early 2000s. So again, our research and our understanding as to why this is coming about has not necessarily gone as far forward as some of the things that we do with respect to bone augmentation and the different techniques that we use in terms of placing the implants. Once we take our break, we're going to talk a little bit about treatment modalities and the difference in terms of the different things that we need to do. So hopefully, all of you who have placed implants in your own patients have established a good maintenance program for them. I'm going to give you at least some tips in terms of what some of the things that are recommended, some of the tools that I use. We're going to talk about some non-surgical therapy approaches and surgical therapy approaches. And hopefully you're going to get a chance, I guess tomorrow afternoon, in the hands-on component, to work with some of the materials that we're talking about here. Again, it's not going to be comprehensive, but hopefully you will have at least a chance to play with some of the materials. Some of the surgical therapy techniques, such as connective tissue grafts, to go on to or be incorporated into our surgical procedures. So you'll have at least an opportunity to have a little bit of a hands-on component, and then we'll talk about some future thoughts and some conclusions at the end, if you guys are all still awake.
For tomorrow afternoon, 4 to 7, there is a workshop in this area where Dr. Goldberg is going to demonstrate hands-on practically doing this. So if you haven't signed up, please sign up, because there's only limited seats. Sign up for the workshop today.
So I'll show you some of the pictures that you will see. So hopefully you have a good idea of who these gentlemen are. You probably know the person on the right. You may not necessarily know the person on your left. The person on the right you may not know. Obviously, P.I. Granemark was the father of implant dentistry, and at least for us in North America, George Czar, who was a faculty member at the University of Toronto, who was very instrumental in bringing implant dentistry to North America, and in essence, basically introducing it to the world at a conference back in 1982, the famous Toronto conference of that year. But this is what they were talking about back in 1982. This is at least what they were used to. Looking at two implants and a completely edentulous arch where you would have two implants placed to hold a removable denture. And that was simple, and that was predictable, and that's where implant dentistry basically got started. But as you all know, we've expanded well beyond that, looking at implants that are associated with supporting bridges, or implants that are associated with supporting single tooth restorations. And again, because we have an oral cavity that has challenges with respect to bone, with respect to the environment, such as bacteria, such as how one goes about keeping both the teeth and the implants clean, all of these are factors that weren't necessarily recognized back in the early 1980s and into the early 90s, when this was basically all we knew from implant dentistry. And so one of the things that came about from early implant dentistry, and if you take a look at the year of this particular study, 1989, talking about the early origin of implant dentistry, that marginal bone loss was acceptable and expected right from the get-go. So what we are defining in terms of peri-implantitis in some cases may in fact be quite within the normal realm. And so this is something that you have to keep in the back of your mind when you're looking at your cases in terms of seeing a little bone loss around the implant fixtures. We'll talk a little bit in a couple of slides about all of that. That bone loss around implants was expected. Now, the rate at which that occurs is going to be variable, and that may ultimately lead to problems with respect to peri-implantitis. But do remember that it is important to understand that bone loss was something that was going to be expected. So is this case that I'm going to show you something that is called peri-implantitis? Here's a closer up view. So is this peri-implantitis? So based on our definitions, and we're going to go over the definitions, you can see that there's obviously been significant bone loss around this particular fixture, 1, 2, 3, 4, about 6 threads that are exposed. However, in this particular case, the patient had been like this for about 15 years. This is a case that I had seen that one of my colleagues actually placed the implants back in the probably mid to late 1990s. And bone loss had occurred. It occurred at a fairly moderate rate right at the beginning and then stabilized. And that's where the bone levels were, where we kept recalling this patient, nothing changed. So yes, we may have peri-implantitis here, but the question that I asked is this something that requires treatment, such as surgical treatment or that type of thing?
So it's a question for the patient still stable.
Soft tissue stable, that's the point. So we're going to talk about, you know, all the factors that you're going to be looking at in terms of making decisions with respect to whether one needs to treat or not. So bone can remodel, you know, again, depending on how deep you place the fixture, you're going to have a varying pocket depth around an individual fixture. You're going to get changes depending on the system that you use in terms of the crestal bone line. And this particular slide kind of illustrates the fact that based on where the micro gap is, based on the depth at which you place the implant, is going to have also an influence on whether or not bone changes are going to occur. So these are all factors that we have to keep in mind before we start calling every case that we see that has bone loss peri-implantitis. I've had some colleagues that have sent me patients over the last few months, and I don't know whether this new consensus report kind of spurred things on. It shouldn't. Anything, it should have calmed the waters. But I've had some patients who have been sent to me with no bone loss, but because of the remodeling, dentists have been exceptionally worried about the fact that they are going to lose their implants. So again, being able to understand what is pathological and what is not pathological is very important in this particular discussion. So again, getting back to that issue. Initial marginal bone loss, again, is something that we do expect. But the late bone loss that happens years down the road, and oftentimes at a very rapid rate, is a pathological, is there an occlusal component? We're going to talk all about this. But there's differences between initial marginal bone loss and bone loss that occurs later on. And that's what we're going to talk about when we talk about peri-implantitis. So I think in a situation like this, if you saw this clinically, I think we would all agree that there's a problem here. You can see that there's obviously, there's suppuration here, there's bleeding that's present here. There is a problem. And that's when we take our x-ray, the problem we see. So this is something that obviously is going to require some treatment, and I'll show you the outcome of this a little bit later on when we get into the treatment. But the problem that we've had, as I say, over the years is defining peri-implantitis. as I mentioned, even to this day, we still don't have a great definition. So there are two components to peri-implant diseases. One is called peri-implant mucositis, and the other is peri-implantitis. Both of them involve an inflammation in the gingival tissue and in the surrounding mucosa. But the difference between mucositis and implantitis is that the fact that there is an effect on supporting bone. And this is not something that's new. Again, this is something that had been defined back in the mid-1990s. So this is not something that we've all of a sudden just discovered as a new condition. Now, what are the clinical concerns? Patients oftentimes will present with pain, with brushing, pain with eating, they'll get bad taste, they'll get bad smells, they may get significant eating and brushes, brushing. These are the types of situations when patients come in with complaints like that, that we have to deal with. Situations where patients are asymptomatic, they may not necessarily realize that they have a problem with respect to bone loss and colitis, but again, is treatment required, like I showed you with that first case? And if so, what type of treatment? And when we talk about treatments, again, when we talk about management with respect to home care and professional care, non-surgical treatment and surgical treatment. So those are the choices that you have. So being able to decide where the patient or where the situation fits into those different treatment modalities is going to be. We know that implants are a big business, and I think Dr. Sehgal mentioned that, you know, this is the easy part. Putting the implants in, you guys can do that. Right? You guys have been trained to do it, you're doing it in your practices. It's a very stepwise approach if you're doing well with respect to your planning. I know Jim Lai, who was the head of the program at the University of Toronto, was here a couple of years ago, talked a lot about treatment planning and the like. So if cases are planned well, you know the steps to put an implant in. That's the easy part. Managing the situation afterwards is where the challenges come into play. So let's start off with the clinical examination. So who probes their implants?
Raise your hand.
Oh, you can raise your hand. Well, nobody puts a probe around the tissue around the implant. Why do we not do that? We'll get into the plastic stuff in a second. But why did you were going to say
what? Usually it goes between some tissue and the blood members, like we call it hands and bones. So we have some pressure. So if you put the probe, we might lose some pressure.
Okay. So that was what the thought was as to why there was this sacred thought that one didn't put a probe into around an implant, because this hemidesmosomal attachment was going to be broken and you were just going to open the environment up to bacteria, etc. That basically had been discounted probably about 10 years ago, where they showed in animal studies that, in fact, by probing, yes, you will break the hemidesmosomal attachment, but within 5 days it will be formed. So the fact is that the thought about not probing has gone by the wayside. It is important that you do probe your implants. We'll talk a little bit about the protocol. So somebody mentioned about a plastic probe.
Or titanium.
Sorry?
Or titanium.
Well, I have my thoughts about that. Because a plastic probe, what's this plastic probe doing that a titanium probe can't do?
Flexibility.
Exactly. So you've got the ability for this probe, and then for those of you again who have restored a lot of implants and have seen a lot of crowns, you have an implant here and a crown that's out here. How are you going to get a titanium probe straight in? And we're going to talk about the probe issue in a second with respect to how one does go about probing and the potential false negatives and false positives that are produced if probed improperly or too aggressive. So I usually advocate using a plastic probe because it's able to get a happen. And again, the more implants you guys are going to do, the more crowns you're going to put into place, you're going to see that it'll be much easier for you to actually navigate around an overconjugal crown. So I know, I first of all, I have no association with any of these companies, and that I'm going to talk about products. I'm not paid for them, but by these companies, I like these products, and that's why I mentioned them. So Hugh Freebie does make a plastic probe that comes with a handle that these plastic probes sometimes do start to deform and bend after a little bit. So they do have to be replaced. So as I say, Hugh Freebie makes one that you buy the handle, and then you screw the tip onto the handle, and you can replace the probes fairly quickly, and it's not very expensive. But I would strongly recommend, if you are doing an implant patient exam, making sure that you do have a plastic probe in your kits. And again, we're dealing with different types of tissues here. The problem that we oftentimes have with respect to understanding what the probing depth means when we're talking about teeth versus implants, the numbers are very different. Again, first of all, if you have more inflammation, be it a tooth or an implant, you're going to be able to probe deeper. But the amount of connective tissue attachment here is greatly reduced around an implant versus a tooth. Therefore, one is potentially going to be able to probe that much deeper around an implant. So the actual number, we're going to keep reinforcing, is the actual number that you get in terms of the probing depth is not necessarily the important thing. We need to record it, but if you think about it, when we talk about teeth, what do we want in terms of probing depth for a healthy situation around the tooth?
2 millimeters, 3 millimeters,
exactly. That number is not important for implants. Again, remember 5 slides ago, it said depending on the depth that you place the implant, depending on how the soft tissue forms around it. Again, if you've got an anterior tooth and you want to have a proper emergence profile, in some cases you have to bury the implant. And in doing so, you're going to create a crevice that may profile 5 millimeters. It doesn't even have peri-implantitis. And that's the problem that we've got with respect to trying to extrapolate some of our perio ideas to the peri-implantitis question. So as I mentioned, it's important to probe, it's important to report the probing, but what we're going to be looking for, we'll talk about a little bit more about this, is the changes that happen. So if you had a crevice depth of 5 millimeters initially, and 4 or 5 years later you had suppuration and you had bleeding on probing, and you were able to probe 8 millimeters, well, that's a problem. But if you had a situation where you took a baseline measurement, probe 6 millimeters around the crevice, and it's been 6 millimeters forever, and there's very minimal inflammation and no suppuration, yeah, that doesn't mean you have peri-implantitis because you have a deeper crevice then. So again, it's all relevant. And we talked about, we don't have to go into too much, I'm sure you guys know about this. This is obviously the difference in terms of the different connections, the hemidentin zonal attachments that are more prominent around an implant, and we talked about that as well. So just to quickly go over predictability in terms of leading on probing around, we know that there are some classic studies that were done by Klaus Lang back in the mid-1980s looking at leading on probing around the teeth, and the fact that you were able to basically understand that it was not a great predictor of future attachment loss around the teeth. Lack of leading on probing was more associated with cuff. Well, the same thing is present with implants. But we do find now that there is a little bit more or better sensitivity when you have bleeding around the implant. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about this just before our break. But the important thing when it comes to probing, and this is the operative word, gentle probing. Because the hemidesmosomal attachments are a little weaker, one of the things that we have to worry about is that if we use the same forces that we use when we're probing teeth around an implant, you're always going to cause bleeding. just because the tissue is more fragile in general than an implant. So it is important that you kind of modify the forces. And this is going to be a personal thing as you go on in your careers. You're going to understand what the differences are in terms of the probing pressures that you put on the tooth versus what you put around an implant. But the operative word is gentle probing around an implant with the plastic probes. So my recommendation to you, when you have placed your implant, you've restored your implant, crown has been in place for about 6 months or so, take a baseline radiograph, take a baseline probing pin. So that way you've now established what your baseline is, and now you're going to look for changes moving forward. So hopefully as time goes on, and you're going to be recalling these implant patients and they remain within your recall practice, you'll be able to then monitor what the clinical situation is and compare it to what your baseline readings are. So this is one thing that, as I say, has changed, that we do advocate that you probe as well as obviously take some baseline radiographs and probably do that at a repeat every So let's now define peri-implant diseases. And this is what our problem is. This is the literature that has been utilized by, if you read any of the studies on epidemiology associated with peri-implantitis, you'll see these names come up, you'll see the Hayes-Mayfield articles come up in 2011. This is what they defined in terms of their peri-implant mucositis definition. So when they were looking at large populations and the inclusion criteria for the Hayes-Mayfield study, it was just simply bleeding on probing to no bone loss. Nothing to do with Krebs depth or anything like that. However, some of the other studies, such as Porras, looked at pocket depth, some looked at plaque index, and that's the problem. You see, just taking a quick glance at this, we're all over the place in terms of our definitions. So nobody really had a good idea in terms of what they wanted to see, because we don't have a unified understanding of what the definition should be. Similarly with peri-implantitis. So you're talking about Stefan Redberg, who's a very big name in managing these particular conditions. Talked about probing depth greater than 5 millimeters, radiographic bone loss greater than 3, but Frank Schwartz talked about 7 millimeters of probing depth. And the Bruce Jansiker article didn't even talk about probing depth at all. So again, you don't have a unified idea or understanding over the years of what our definitions of peri-implantitis. So hopefully we can try to at least give you some parameters, but as I mentioned, even in the 2017 consensus report, there's still some questions about it. 2013, the American Academy of Periodontology produced a white paper, again trying to identify or define the differences between mucositis and peri-implantitis. And again, as we talked about, the differences is that based on mucositis, that there was bone loss that was going to be acceptable, but again, based on the initial remodeling that was happening with the bone. And of course, peri-implantitis was progressive supporting bone loss beyond the biological bone remodeling we would expect. The problem is, again, how much is what would we expect? Again, depending on how deep you place the implant, etc., etc. So the fact is that even in this 2013 white paper, it still didn't help with respect to our definitions. And so that's the problem. We have a problem with defining what peri-implantitis actually is. We know that there's an infectious component that has to be part of this. So from that standpoint, we know that that's one element that we're going to have to look at, but we're going to talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. But some studies suggested that we're dealing with different types of bacteria. Some studies looked at it from the standpoint of the same types of bacteria that we see in our garden variety perio diseases. So the question again becomes, do we need to treat these situations differently? Are we dealing with an extension of periodontal disease? Can we manage it the same way? And so again, these are more questions than we have. let's talk about some risk indicators of periodontal disease. And so these are the same risk indicators that they looked at for periodontitis as well. Talk about poor oral hygiene, past history of periodontal disease, smoking, and we're going to talk a little bit about smoking, some interesting findings from that consensus report. Genetics may have a role to play, diabetes, lack of keratinized tissue is a big controversy at this point, but all of these are factors when it comes to periodontal disease and what makes an individual more susceptible to that. Those same types of factors are being looked at when it comes to periodontitis. So when we assess different elements of the individual, we obviously look at saliva, we talk about bleeding, probing, suppuration, we look at particular fluids and different types of factors that are present in the particular fluid. We're obviously looking at bacteria and radiographs. So does anybody have any questions, at least up to this point? So, you know, why is epidemiology important? You know, I'm going to throw a whole bunch of different numbers in that at you, but you know, these are the types of things that, you know, just on the top of your head, when a patient asks you, how likely am I going to have this problem? These are the numbers that you should be throwing with. So I know sometimes you get into these studies and it can be a little bit boring and too many numbers, and probably not going to help you too much in terms of this because the numbers are all over the place. But there are a couple of studies that I want you to go back and to look at, because these are studies that are kind of ones that are oft quoted in terms of defining the numbers in terms of the incidence of peri-implantitis and peri-implant mucus disease. So again, when you're talking to your patients and explaining to them why you're talking to them about it, you can talk to them about the fact that this is quite a common problem, and based on such and such a study, these are the numbers as to why it is important.
And yeah, there was a smoking 3.6 and 4.6.
It's the range. Well, depending on the studies, it's a range. So it's called an odds ratio. So it's the odds of you running into a problem compared to not smoking. So smoker versus non-smoker, you're 4.5 times more likely to develop a problem. And that's kind of what we understand, at least in terms of the risk of periodontal disease developing in an individual who's a smoker. They're, again, 3.5 to 4.5 times
more. But all doctor research agrees that bleeding on probing is a sign of pre-implantitis.
Is it? It's a sign.
A sign? It's the main sign.
It's one of the signs.
Yeah, but all of them agree on this side.
But whether
we have bone loss or without bone loss, separation or without separation.
True, but again, you need to make sure that the reason you're getting the bleeding is because there's inflammation, not just because you probe too hard. And that's where you have to kind of be careful in terms of interpreting bleeding too aggressively. So in other words, as I say, I can probe almost any implant if I probe the same way that I'm probing around my teeth, and I can produce bleeding. Does that mean I have peri-implantitis and I have to treat it? So that's why I say you have to be very careful with that, because as you know, you can traumatize the tissue very easily. Over contoured crowns, you're going in at a different angle, you can traumatize the tissue very easily. So you can cause bleeding on probing quite easily, but does it require treatment? So that's why you need some of, yes, so bleeding on, your statement is right that bleeding on probing needs to be present, but now they're usually suggesting that other elements need to be present.
Let's say this technique's sensitive.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So one of the studies that I would recommend going back to take a look at is the Dirk study. This was a systematic review of the epidemiology up to that point in time, but as I say, even in the 2017 physician paper, they still refer to this Dirk study. And there's another study by Atiyah that I'll give you the reference in a few minutes. But these are studies that look at basically taking, you guys all know what a systematic review is. So they're basically taking a whole bunch of different studies, looking to try to combine them so that they can increase the power of the study by increasing the populations of the world. So they try to utilize this in order to again be able to give again a more powerful statement as to some of the reasons why peri-implantitis comes about and what some of the numbers are in terms of the frequency. Again, the problem is the studies that I just showed you a couple of slides ago, you saw how different all of the definitions were, and that's the problem. It's hard to combine studies. So they looked at 3,000 and some odd different articles and whittled it down to 15. Our, just as an aside, our literature in perio and dentistry is poor from that perspective. These types of systematic reviews and meta-analysis in medicine are much more powerful because the studies are very, very similar. So you can combine studies very easily. Dentistry doesn't seem to have that. So if you read any of the systematic reviews, you have to be careful. If you read any of the Cochrane reports, again, a lot of the time we'll look at 3,000, 4,000 papers and only be able to take the information from 5, 8, 10. So it tells us something about our literature, but it is what we have. As you said, about 3,800 articles, 27 were identified for full text analysis, and only 15 made it to the final review. But these are the 15 papers that at least in 2018 are what we utilized to make our decisions in terms of numbers. So in terms of defining mucositis, in the papers that we looked at, or that were looked at in this particular study, as I mentioned, there were some problems with respect to definitions and that there were variability. A couple of papers just looked at bleeding on probing and bone loss, leading on probing with a few friends exposed, different types of pocket depth. With peri-implantitis, same type of thing. You still have a lot of variability with respect to what your definitions were. And these are the papers that were ultimately included. But one of the papers that oftentimes is quoted is a paper by Bruce Jansiker. The reason that it's quoted is that because it's got a fairly long-term follow-up. Now the problem with this paper is that, again, because it's about a 15-year follow-up, the implant systems that were looked at were much older. So you were talking about smooth surface Nobel implants. Not many people use those anymore. So sometimes it's hard to extrapolate things based on this study alone. But you'll see that this paper is going to be quoted in this series of papers. So you have Bruce Jansen's got a bunch of papers. I think it was a three-part series. And what they suggested in terms of the rate of peri-implantitis seemed to be higher in patients that had a past history of periodontal disease. So if you had periodontal disease that was treated, even if it was treated, your risk of running into peri-implantitis problems was slightly higher. So again, another reason why it's important, especially if you have patients that you're putting implants in that lost their teeth because of periodontal problems, it's an important conversation that you have to have with them. And it's an important thought process that you need to go through as well. That just simply taking out teeth and putting implants in and saying, calling it a day and saying, I've done this patient a service, is not necessarily going to be effective in all situations. So you have to make sure that if you have a conversation with your patient that their risk of running into trouble years down the road may be slightly increased. Again, in the Bruce Jansiker study, 48% of their population had peri-implant mucositis. And that tends to be obviously a much more readily identified situation. So again, leading to suppuration, that type of thing. But look at that, half the patients had peri-implant mucositis. So again, a discussion with your patient about the fact that we're putting this implant in, but that doesn't mean that we're done with our treatment. This is something that needs to be maintained and managed, not only from the patient's home care standpoint, but from a professional standpoint. And even then, there may need to be some additional treatments done in order to help maintain these implants at some point down the road. If the patient goes into the whole implant process with their eyes open to something like this, you're not going to run into trouble. Where you're going to run into trouble is that, well, you told me that this was going to be, you know, basically, if I replaced my teeth with this, I wasn't going to have any trouble. And now I have trouble. So it's an important conversation to have with your patient. Again, mucositis, depending on the study that you read, Ferreira's study showed even 65% of the population had some type of mucositis. And again, on average from this systematic review, anywhere from 1 to 47% of patients had some type of peritonitis. The mean was about 22%. Given that there were all over the place with respect to numbers and our definition, back in 2012, the European Workshop of Periodontology tried to at least come up with some recommendations with respect to prevalence and incidence. So again, looking at prevalence and incidence, the difference is one is cross-sectional, one is longitudinal. So for example, where there's no baseline radiograph, so this is a patient who may come into your office and as you know, you had no previous relationship with them or with the implant, you may want to at least define peri-implantitis as at a bone level 2 millimeters beyond what is expected in terms of bone loss. Whereas incidence would be if you took baseline radiographs, took baseline readings, 1 to 1.5 millimeters of bone loss with clinical information. So again, trying to further define what we consider peri-implantitis. Now the second study that I wanted you to kind of go back and take a look at, this is one in the Journal of Periodontology, TI. This was also a systematic review. Came out a little bit before the Dirk study, 2013, but it basically looked at the same papers and had a basically the same type of approach. And they didn't screen nearly as many articles. They only had 9 that were selected for the meta-analysis. But their criteria was that they made sure that the implants were in place for at least 5 years. But their high-risk factors were considered smoking, diabetes, and periodontal disease as their main risk factors for developing peri-implantitis and peri-implantitis. And again, those are the same studies. So overall, from these meta-analyses, depending on how you want to quote, at the patient level or the implant, what are we talking about? Some patients may have implants that are completely healthy in the same mouth that has an implant that has peri-implantitis or mucositis. So it's possible, that's why you have to look at it from the standpoint of the difference between looking at it from an implant level or a patient level. But I mean, if you want to look at it primarily from a patient level, about 63% of patients who have implants will have mucositis.
When you say from patient level, you still mean natural nutrition or still implants?
It's just implants. We're just talking implants, yeah.
So
When you're talking about the implant level, this is 30% of implants. Whereas when you're talking about patient level, because you can have 10 implants in the mouth, 5 may be completely healthy and 5 may have mucositis. I'm sure you've seen lots of patients that, you know, they've got other implants that are completely fine and a couple have. So, you know, you can look at it whatever you want to, you feel comfortable quoting to your patients. But again, if you're looking at almost 65% of patients will come in with mucositis, will have some problem with mucositis. And almost 20% of patients will have peri-implantitis. These are numbers that to this day are still being utilized in terms of suggesting that we've got a problem. So implants are not a panacea. They're not something that you put into the patient's mouth and then forget about it. This is the part of the discussion that you need to have with your patients prior to even placing the implant, prior to getting started with your planning. Because unless they buy into this possibility, don't start treatment. One of the other things that we looked at the University of Toronto was kind of incorporating pain into it. If you looked at all the previous criteria, we actually were just talking about, again, probing depth, and we were talking about the level of bone loss around an implant. But one of the things that wasn't really looked at was pain. So we started coming up with, or we came up with our own little system where we actually looked at defining peri-implant mucosal inflammation and pain with probing, along with those other factors, as another criteria to look at with respect to defining this particular condition. And so again, if there was mucositis with pain with probing, there would be, depending on what the level of bone loss around the implants was, that would define a certain type of treatment protocol that we would come up with. But we advanced that a little bit further, and this is what our current system is. You'll have this in the hands-on course that you'll get your handout with this. But we have defined different categories of problem with respect to mucositis and implantitis. So we define category A as no bone loss, peri-implant mucositis was bleeding on probing present, but no suppuration, right? No implant mobility. And this will have a certain criteria that will lead to a certain level of treatment. Category B would be suppuration present. And once we get to category C, this is when we start seeing bone loss around the implant. So up to about 25% of bone loss around an implant would be category C. Category D would be about 26-50%. And then category E, greater than 50%. And obviously category F would be a mobile implant, likely. And so these will all have treatment implications that we'll talk about in a couple of minutes. So any questions about the epidemiology? So hopefully I've given you a little bit of an overview and some numbers that you can utilize with discussions with your patients. And now let's talk a little bit about the etiology. Because you talked, Sahel mentioned about cleaning and bacteria. That we all know. You know, if we can keep an implant clean, if you can keep your teeth clean, the chances of you developing problems are going to be reduced. But there are probably other factors, just like in periodontal disease, that may be contributory to why patients may develop mucositis or peri-implantitis. And we see that, as we just talked about, in an individual's mouth. There will be some situations where, in one mouth, you will have completely healthy implants, and on the other side of the arch, you have bone loss and attachment loss. Why is that the case? You can't say it's solely from bacteria. There may be other factors that one needs to consider, and that's what we're going to talk about now. So some of those factors, again, we've talked about the bacteria, the differences in terms of different structural differences with the tissue, how the body responds to the presence of bacteria, and that may differ from person to person, and that where you may see varying levels of attachment loss. Subgingival cement obviously is a problem. Hopefully we're all trying to have screw retained implants, so we don't have to worry about cement. We'll talk about implant occlusion, positioning, surface designs, etc. So let's talk a little bit about the micro. We touched on this a little bit earlier from the standpoint of with the microbiology. We know that from this, from where we came from with respect to thinking that this was, in essence, a continuum of periodontal disease, the initial studies really just started to look at the classic perio pathogens. And that's where the studies kind of focused. And even to some extent to this day, we're still kind of focused on the usual periopathogens. So just as a quick reminder, we know that our red complex, everybody knows what the different complexes are of bacteria. Does this look familiar at all? So back in the 90s, they actually, a study that was done looking at trying to categorize pathogenic bacteria based on common features. This was done by a group in the United States, where the most pathogenic bacteria were defined as the red complex bacteria. So this is P. digitalis, Panarella forsythia, and Treponema dentifolium, and spirochetes. So these are the ones that's bringing you hopefully back to your dental school days. ones that are most pathogenic. And so those are the ones that were primarily looked at as being the primary etiological agents when it comes to bacteria. We also started looking at some of the orange complex bacteria, A as well, Bacillus combatans was looked at as well. And so the problem is that, you know, when you're talking about biofilms, they sometimes can be difficult to eradicate. And so this study actually mimicked a study that was done back in the 70s, the classic study that was done by Lowe, where they actually stopped treatment on a bunch of dentists for 2 weeks, saw the bacteria levels rise, saw the level of gingivitis rise, reinstituting hygiene, bacteria went down, and the inflammation went down. They repeated this same type of study by Salving, actually fairly recently, and got exactly the same type of curve. So the fact was is that, again, it was thought that bacteria and the accumulation of bacteria is ultimately what led to the problems with respect to inflammation. So again, keeping bacteria under control, and that was going to be all that was required. So again, we know about biofilms and systemic antibiotics. Treating biofilms is important. So, showing you a case. This was a 69-year-old female. She was referred to us by the Toronto Public Health. She had no significant medical history, pain with chewing. She had an implant-supported overdenture that was placed in 2009. She claimed that she was going to the dentist every 3 months for cleanings. However, if you take a look, there is a lot of bacteria and plaque here. But more importantly, you can see the suppuration is present, the inflammation is present all over here. Now I want you to just take a look at the tissue height and see how much it's overgrown over the guard. So this was initially. And you can see that she started to lose some bone around the implants and that as well. So we placed her initially on a course of a systemic antibiotic. We debrided the area, and we also provided some local delivery antibiotic therapy as well. So we'll talk a little bit about that tomorrow, or actually later on in the lecture. Literally within 2 weeks, take a look at the tissue. The tissue still looks a little bit on the red side, but look at how much it shrunk down. And you can actually almost see where the tissue crept up to here, and how much it shrunk. So again, here's a better picture of it. So that's where the tissue was sitting initially, and how much it shrunk down within 2 weeks. So that's an example of that previous study that I just showed you by Salving, whereby, again, removing the biofilm, treating it both systemically as well as local delivery antibiotics, actually provided a benefit here for this patient. And here you can see that we got her back onto a more consistent recall. Here's a comparison between the before. So as I mentioned, historically we saw periodontal disease and the association of certain bacteria with healthy pockets, with gram-positive species, cocci rods, the gram-negative species that I showed you, the anaerobic species, those are all the red complex bacteria, so the orange complex bacteria, these are what we felt were associated with periodontitis. And there were some classic studies that were done back in the 1990s that looked at patients that had problems with respect to gingivitis, with high levels of P. gingivalis, and these particular patients had were able to culture those. A Rutger-Person study back in the as we got more sophisticated with respect to our assessments of bacteria with DNA checkerboard hybridization, different types of bacteria, but again, ones that were associated with periodontal disease. Were ultimately discovered. So this is kind of reinforcing the fact that the pathogens that were present in the periodontal disease were probably contributing to periodontitis. And this was a follow-up study that Pearson had done as well. Same thing with the maximum study. I'm going to just skip it. forward here, that basically we have a mixed bacterial infection that was dominated by gram-negative anaerobic species, and it's consistent with what we see with the periodontal disease and the rem natural teeth. But Pranima Kumar, who we work with at Ohio State University, has a supercomputer that they're able to do a lot of high volume throughput of bacteria samples. And they were actually able to show that the bacteria around teeth in chronic periodontitis patients was actually quite different from what was seen around implants. They actually found a number of very distinct species when they were looking at healthy teeth and healthy implants. They also found distinct species when they looked at peri-implantitis and periodontitis species. In fact, they found that most, almost 75% of the peri-implant species belong to three genera, and in fact that they were very different than what we see in our periodontitis patients. One of the species that they found are firmicutes. This was present in about 53%, which is not necessarily commonly seen in periodontal patients. And so from that perspective, we oftentimes see that there may in fact be quite a difference between the bacteria that's present here. And another neat study that was done by NAPDU, where they looked at teeth that were adjacent to one another, and they actually cultured the bacteria and put it through high throughput computers. And so from that perspective, we actually see that there was more red complex bacteria in the sulcus that were found around teeth, but around the adjacent implants, only 37% of those implants actually had those bacteria. So even in implants and teeth that were right beside each other, the bacteria profile was quite different. So yes, we know that bacteria is the big factor, obviously, and it's probably associated with various pathogens. But what bacteria in particular, we still really don't have a good idea. And this was just a study of all the different bacteria that you studied. And finally, Albertini looked at opportunistic bacteria, see if Candida albicans may be associated. So yeast infections, in fact, may be associated with this. There's even literature looking at viral infections that might be associated with this as well. So the jury is still out in terms of what pathogens in particular may be leading to these particular problems. A more recent study by LaFerry actually showed that in patients that had peri-implantitis, these were the different bacteria that were actually found. Periodontitis and in health. In fact, there were only a few species that overlap, of course, the red complex that were here. But you've got a lot of unique species that were present in peri-implantitis that are not commonly found in periodontitis or in healthy situations. So again, bacteria is important to trigger this process. I think bacteria is necessary. Which bacteria cause these problems, I think, are still moving on, subgingival cements. So hopefully, are everybody for the most part doing screw retained implants here? We're trying to? Are we still using some pitches? Yeah, good. All right, so hopefully this is becoming less of an issue.
Can I just ask a question? There was a very strong conclusion by Carl Misch and his institute that occlusion is the first reason for bone loss. I think as time has gone by, that concept is no longer being spoken about.
We're going to talk about that. So subgingival cements. Obviously, this is quite obvious. You have any type of material that gets down below the gingival margins and into the soft tissue can lead to an inflammatory response that ultimately will lead to some bone loss. The fact that we are trying to move away from cements, and the problem was is that as the thought processes with respect to implant placement went from the bone guiding the implant placement to ultimately having the prosthetics drive the implant placement had led to a lot of misplacement of implants which required cemented grounds, which led to more of a problem of this nature. And as companies have come up with solutions for those off-angle implants and that, but Tom Wilson has done a lot of work looking at cement in terms of some of the criteria that were associated with cement removal and what the response would be. And in his particular study, he looked at 42 test implants, 10 controls, all demonstrated some level of cement-induced peri-implantitis. And again, once the cement was removed, basically within a month, everything kind of resolved. There were problems with respect to the early cements, because many of these cements were not radio-opaque, so it was difficult to actually find them. Nowadays, they are making radio-opaque cement, so it's becoming less of an issue if one does require cement. And again, removing the cement seemed to be the big solution to the problem. But what other thing might there be that might contribute to some type of subgingival foreign body? Sorry?
Impression
material could be one thing. Anything else? That they've actually done some studies on. It's the material that actually formulates an implant. Titanium. Yeah. So they've actually looked at, some studies have actually looked at titanium. So again, Tom Wilson looked at, did some biopsies around peri-implantitis cases. And he actually obtained materials that they found bacteria, etc. But at the microscopic level, they identified some type of foreign body that was cement. But they also found 9 additional cases where they couldn't identify the material. And so when they looked at it a little bit more closely, they actually found that it was titanium. The question was, how did the titanium get in?
Detection from the...
Well, that was one of the theories, that it may detach during the implant placement process. Is it possible that if somebody is scaling, maybe not the best instruments, and that they're using non-titanium instruments, that they may be scratching the surfaces and leaving titanium particles behind? That was one of the thoughts as well. So Tom Wilson had a number of samples that he looked at that actually did show titanium presence below the gum line. There was another study that was done. So again, we talked about the frictional placement of the implant at that time. There was another study in 2016 that kind of discounted that. During sanative therapy, corrosion. Is it possible that the surface may corrode a little bit and leak some of the titanium into the environment? So again, these are other factors. This is beyond just bacteria that might be contributing to peri-implantitis. Sanative therapy, cleaning. So while you're cleaning the implant, if you're scratching the surface, in the next section we're going to talk about the instruments that we use. But if you're using, for example, steel curettes, which can scratch the implant surface, then you can potentially cause damage that may release some of the material into the environment. Tissue structure. So what do we know, or what do we think about the need for keratinized tissue? Do we need keratinized tissue around an implant for it to be successful?
Yes.
All the time?
No. Not really.
Do you have any literature that backs that up? Okay, let's talk about that. Alright, so is there a need for keratinized tissue around an implant? That is the question. So this was a case that I had, actually, that I had done several years ago. I've been doing a lot of planning of the implants with respect to doing guided surgeries. And so this was a case that, you know, when I done the plan for the guided surgery, I knew there was going to be a mucogingival defect, but the tissue was going to be very thin. So I urged the patient, you know, need to, you know, do a graft. And he said, no, I don't want to do it. Let's just see what happens. And so we ended up placing the implant, crown went into place. You can see that there is thin tissue in this area, but again, free of inflammation, no bleeding on probing. And this is about 4 years after I replaced the implant. Yeah, long term, maybe things will change. But the literature is still somewhat not definitive, as you guys know, with respect to the need for keratinized tissue. I'll give you my own thoughts on that after we go through this. So obviously what the pros are, historically we know that around the teeth, making sure that you have an adequate amount of carotenoid ginger is important. It does help with respect to maintenance, it does help with respect to minimizing trauma from food, etc., toothbrushing and the like. So it is usually ideally you want to try to help to keep an area as free of inflammation as possible, and obviously the thicker the tissue is, you've got a little bit better buffer. So we know around teeth that the Lane Low study, the classic study, looked at the need for a certain amount of carotenoid tissue, and it was suggested that if you had at least 2 millimeters of carotenoid tissue, you could maintain good gingival health. There was also a classic study that kind of refuted that. The Dorothy Kennedy study suggested that even with minimum zones of intact gingiva, you could still maintain health as long as you kept the inflammation. So that's kind of the both sides of the story. Now, when we talk about implants, though, we are on two different sides of the story, too. So there was a study by Masada that looked at restoration subgingival margins, that there was basically less than 2 millimeters of carotenoid tissue, and that didn't seem to, that seemed to cause potential problems, whereas Anne Wenstrom's study showed that there was no difference in inflammation with the amount of carotenoid tissue present. So for teeth, a lot of the time we do it on a preventative level. Again, what about implants? Well, with respect to implants, Anton and Skoulian had looked at it in 2017, and they did a retrospective study. And his summary suggested that there was limited data on the benefits and predictability of the gingival procedures around implants. There was no evidence that soft tissue augmentation will affect peri-implant bone levels, and the only indication as of this time to do a gingival graft is to optimize hygiene or for aesthetic reasons. But just to quickly go over how one goes about assessing, we all know how to assess carotenoid tissue levels and the like. So you know that the probing depth, you subtract the domestic attachment, gingival margin versus the base of the bone, and how much is actually attached. That's what your carotenoid tissue is. So there's your mucogingival junction. You're looking at the amount of tissue above the mucogingival junction so you can grow. Again, we usually like to pull the tissue out, and you can actually more definitively see the mucogingival junction here, and you can see, at least in this natural tooth set, setting, that there's a very thin amount of carotenoid tissue here. You can see that the probe is basically able to penetrate almost past the mucogingival junction. But here's a situation where, again, you've got minimal attachment, you've got carotenoid, a good carotenoid tissue on the adjacent teeth. This is a story for implants different. And as we mentioned, the long-term implant survival does not seem to be affected by the amount of carotenoid tissue present. Inflammation may be present, and obviously if a patient is having trouble with respect to maintaining their teeth because of the thin tissue, because it's painful to brush, that may be a different indication. But if one is able to maintain the area free of inflammation and free of pain, then there's not necessarily an indication that one has to graft. So according to Greenstein in 2011, the indications for grafting around implants, if the site was chronically inflamed, if there was ongoing recession, if it was sore to brush, if there was a past history of periodontal recession, and obviously if there was a desire to improve aesthetics, we'll talk about that when it comes to implants. And here's just a quick case for you. This is a 27-year-old female, no medical history of any concern, but her symptom was that she had a divot in her gum. So this was the implant. There was no problems with respect to the crustal bone level. But you can see the inflammation in the divot that was present there, from the hole in the gum. There was basically a fenestration there. So we did a connective tissue graft, basically thickening up the tissue. But these types of things are risky in these situations. And this was a little less risky because I knew that there was good bone. there's a problem with a mucogingival issue and there's bone loss, the predictability goes out the window because there's no blood supply that you're going to be able to gain from the implant. It's not going to be able to attach soft tissue to the implant. So you have to be very, very careful in terms of your decision making, when you're especially dealing with an aesthetic area, as to whether or not you actually do graft in terms of trying to either thicken up the tissue or definitely for aesthetic reasons.
Could the soft tissue graft you bought from the palate throat? You tried to use the IF against not using the
My personal preference is always to use the palate tissue. I think it's the most responsive and it gives us the most leeway in terms of success as well. So I always like to use the more recent studies looking at shallow vestibules, and again, if you're having trouble with respect to maintaining a site because of a shallow vestibule, sometimes you can have increased amounts of bone loss. So you can see in this particular case, shallow vestibule, same patient, and you've got significant bone loss where they had a deeper vestibule, more keratinized tissue, healthier bone. And so here again is one of those examples where within the same mouth, you have two different clinical scenarios presented themselves. So let me just go back and give you my bent on the mucogingival situation. Do we need to at least do connective tissue grafts or augment the keratinized tissue replacing it? Not necessarily. But if you can see that there's going to be an obvious deficiency prior to even placing the implant, I've done this for some of my oral surgery colleagues, where I've actually done some pre-implant placement gum grafts in order to thicken up the tissue to give the surgeon a little bit more to work with. So it's not unreasonable to do it pre-treatment. If at the time of implant placement, although I don't love to do it because I want to make sure the implant works, but definitely before the crown goes into place, if there's a mucogingival defect, that's the time to do any type of graft. Because you can play with the margins, you can play with where you're going to be placing the tissue before the crown goes into place. Once the crown goes into place and you start to get soft tissue changes, that makes it more difficult to graft. And especially again in aesthetic areas, and as I mentioned before, if you've got thread exposure, you've got thin tissue, my worry is that you could make a situation worse by opening up the gums at that point and trying to add more tissue to it. Because again, you can't predict necessarily whether the tissue is going to completely survive. Maybe you can thicken up the gums, but you may get recession along the way. So for those of you that are coming to the workshop, we're going to talk a little bit about connective tissue grafting, so you'll get a chance to at least practice that a little bit. But I usually try to avoid it. Again, if I can do it before the final crown goes into place, that's when I will do it. Or I will try to only do it if, again, the patient is having a problem with respect to managing the case, that we're doing a surgical procedure and we're incorporating a soft tissue graft into the process. And that's where, as I say, I'll show you that in the second section. Post responses. We do know that both peri-implantitis and periodontitis, the inflammatory cell infiltrating the area, occurs lateral to the pocket. We get plasma cells, we get lymphocytes that are dominated. The thing that is different in peri-implantitis versus periodontitis is that the inflammatory response is much, much greater when you're talking about peri-implantitis. So you're going to get a much larger array of cells. You're going to get a broader area that these inflammatory cells are going to place. They're still predominated by neutrophils and macrophages, and also obviously in and around the periodontal tissue. Now we talked a little bit about past history of periodontal disease earlier when it came to the epidemiology talk, and the same thing goes here in peri-implantitis talk, as well as an origin to the problem. So here's a case, 66-year-old female who's been taking Fosamax. She had severe periodontal disease. She had had extractions done. She had implants that were placed in 2010, But soon after the placement of the implants, she was starting to develop bone loss, particularly here. So she had some temporary clamps placed as she was starting to lose her implants. And the problem that we have here, this is a patient that had periodontal disease, and as you can see, the dentist who made this really didn't give her much space in terms of providing any type of cleanliness. She had terrible trouble trying to get in between the crowns here, and ultimately that's where she was starting to develop some of her problems. So we made sure that when the final prosthesis went in, we had the dentist create a little bit more space for her to get instruments in there in order to be able to clean this more appropriately. So that may be one of the things that you will need to consider from the restorative standpoint. Yes, closing up spaces, making it more aesthetic may be one thing, but if you're trading off being able to properly clean the area, especially in a patient that has periodontal disease, is actually potentially a problem.
I have a question regarding this.
Yep.
In this case, if you make a bridge between two implants,
yep.
I see there's a much better concrete implant in the
HR. I agree. Because the problem is the three implants, usually the middle implant always gets prominent. Because as much as you're going to try to make a passive fit, you don't get a passive fit. I'd rather have just two implants and a bridge versus three implants, because invariably that's where we see a lot. Just moving on with respect to periodontal health, again, I think we've talked about this, so I don't want to belabor it, but in a recent article that came out 2018, so just earlier this year, history of periodontitis, a risk factor for periodontal disease. And again, the conclusions were the patients with a history of periodontitis are at considerable risk of being affected by periodontitis, if not periodontitis. So again, we've talked about the discussion that you have to have with the patient. I'm going to show you a case that's one exception to the rule. So this was a patient that I had seen in my practice probably around 2006-2007, actually. You can see that she had a past history of periodontal problems. You can see the extent of bone loss. She lost a tooth here. And we ultimately placed an implant into this area. The interesting thing about this particular case is kind of the opposite happened. If you take a look, she came into my office because she had had an abscess with another tooth. I had seen her in about 7 years. And look at the extent of bone loss that had increased. If you take a look back here, definitely had problems, but they worsened quite substantially. Her periodontal disease has actually progressed quite significantly. But take a look at the implant. Exactly. The implant's not the only thing that actually looks good in it. So here is the one exception, I would say, to the rule. But I wouldn't bank on this being the usual outcome. So this I was kind of surprised at. Exactly, that's probably it. All right, implant surface design.
So, doctor,
yeah.
The biggest patient, if he came to the clinic with mobile teeth, what would be the treatment, best treatment?
So, if the patient came to the clinic and
with mobile teeth, or mobile?
All mobile?
Yeah.
Well,
what's the best treatment now for?
Well, again, you'd have to look at the prognosis. You've got to look at all of the factors that were associated with it. You know, you talk about all of fours and things like that. But there, when we get into the second part of the lecture, and actually more tomorrow, those are the types of cases that we're going to talk a little bit about how you manage and some of the things that we would do. As I don't know if you've ever heard of the term belt and suspenders. So you wear suspenders to hold your pants up, and you wear a belt because you want to be doubly sure your pants don't fall down. So that's the kind of approach that you would want to take in a case like that, because you know, based on the fact that the teeth are extremely mobile, they're obviously with some level of susceptibility to periodontal disease.
There's no caries, nothing.
Right, so that's what I mean. So, you know, that there's an extreme, that there likely is some systemic element that is contributing to it. So there are some things that we are doing with medicines, different types of medicines that we use to help to maybe blunt some of the host response. Yeah, and we're hoping to. You know, I can't necessarily say if you do this, you're going to be 80% less likely to run into a problem.
you know, you're still going to potentially be at high risk because of why you have the disease to begin with. But that's why I say we're taking a belt and suspenders. We're trying to do whatever we can to maybe minimize the problem. But that's why you have to have that discussion. Because you have to tell them, listen, your teeth are all loose because you had gum disease. You know, you, especially if it's in, let's say, if somebody that's 40 years old. Yeah. People don't come in at 40 years old with all loose teeth unless something else is going on. Sure, bacteria is a part of it, but I've got lots of patients I know that never go to the dentist and don't have that problem. So there's something systemically that's likely contributing to their perio problem. The same thing could happen with their implants. So they shouldn't necessarily expect that, you know, we're going to replace it. We have to. You don't have a choice. But you're going to have to work at trying to hang on to this. We're going to have to do this to try to prevent things. You're going to have to come for, you know, regular maintenance, et cetera, et cetera. So. So I get a lot of patients that come to me who have very little access that were given amoxicillin. So without getting into a micro antibiotic lecture, what's the spectrum of activity for amoxicillin or penicillin? You know what's aerobic, gram positive, maybe a little bit of gram negative. What are a periodontal abscess? What are the primary bacteria? Gram negative, anaerobic, etc. So they had antibiotics, they felt maybe a little better, but they didn't really deal with the origin. So this is what I mean, you have to look at it in the context.
Yes, so what do you think that's the best?
Well, I give things like metronidazole, which is a primarily works against anaerobic gram-negative species, fiber sheets, etc. So that's usually what a lot of periodontists give in terms of their go-to antibiotic. So that's... So moving on to the implant surface design. There really doesn't seem to be any issue with respect to smooth surface, rough surface, whether that has any type of influence on the development of peri-implantitis. They've even done some more recent studies where they've been looking at smooth surface of porcelain or zirconian type of implants, and they really haven't found any type of difference with respect to the outcomes as far as the incidence of peri-implantitis. Wenstrom did a study back in the early 2000s where there was no increased risk in rough surface versus machine surface development of peri-implantitis. And some later studies actually also suggested the same type of thing. So the fact is that from Renberg kind of did an overview study, there's limited evidence suggesting that surface characteristics of an implant have a contributing factor. And as we saw in some of the earlier studies where they looked at the Ruzgantiker study that was all done on smooth surface implants, 9 to 14 year follow up, and that's what had the 40 some odd percent of peri-implant mucositis and 20 some odd percent of peri-implantitis. So the surface itself doesn't seem to matter too much in terms of making one even more or less susceptible to problems. So when a salesperson comes in and says to you that they've got these user-friendly implants that are going to be revolutionize the fact that you won't get peri-implantitis because they're smooth surface, don't believe them. Two bets are held up. Now we're going to talk about the occlusion. And it'll be a quick conversation because as he had mentioned, you know, some of the earlier beliefs were that all of these problems came about because of occlusion. And you guys have all been trained that you know that you have to keep your occlusal contacts light. So I'm taking out the iatrogenin, or the densest cause of occlusal issues. And obviously, if you overload the implant, even then, there's not necessarily a lot of evidence to say that you will develop periodontitis, but you probably are increasing the risk to some extent. But for the properly built and properly occluding implant, there doesn't seem to be really any evidence to suggest that there is any type of increased risk of developing periodontitis. The reason that they thought that that might be the case is that they've done some modeling where they looked at the highest points of stress, where obviously the implant abutment of the implant needs would be the areas where stress is highest, and from that perspective, that's where you might actually see bone loss, obviously. But any studies that have been done on animal studies, it's been difficult to really obtain an unbiased opinion on this. And again, going to that 2017 consensus report, again, they basically suggested that occlusion, and even occlusal forces that are non-direct, lateral forces, etc., do not necessarily make one susceptible to periodontitis. But it doesn't mean you become careless with respect to how you go about managing your case, but that doesn't seem to be a big issue with respect to it. So I think Sohail had mentioned that and alluded to it, and this kind of reinforces it. Now here is a case that just got published last year in the American Dental Association Journal, where basically a patient was followed for several years. They found that there was an occlusal discrepancy in the sense that there was heavy occlusion that ultimately contributed to some bone loss here. They took the fixture off, they rejigged it in such a way that they cleaned it out and actually took the occlusion down, and they found after about a year that the bone returned. This is a one case report type of situation.
Did not see bone graft, nothing?
No bone graft, nothing. All they did was they took the fixture off, adjusted the occlusion, cleaned it, and put it back in place. So as I said, this is a one-off, you know, occlusal trauma case. Implant positioning. So this is where you guys come into play in terms of how you go about managing and planning your cases. So this was a 46-year-old female, no medical history, presented in 2009. She wanted to have more implants in quadrant two. She wanted four implants, they settled on three implants. But following the placement of the implants, she seemed to have a lot of just chronic inflammation around one or two of the implants. Around 2012, so again about 3 years later, they started to note bone loss. Now you can see when they were planning this particular case out and where the implant was going to go here, the amount of bone where it was ultimately going to be required was actually quite thin on the bottom. And that was basically the big problem here on this 26 implant. And you can see that this is kind of what alerted the patient to the concern that she ended up developing this big, basically a lump of inflamed tissue that we tried to curette and cut it away, etc., but it kept recurring. And if you take a look closely along the line here, you can see that there is, I guess, where the access hole is for this particular crown, it is slightly to the buckle. But based on the amount of bone that was present there, the probability is that that was going to actually not incorporate the entire implant.
But the single crown or the bridge?
These were
bridge.
It was a bridge.
Why is it not single crown?
The University of Toronto tends to like to do bridges for restorative purposes. It's easier for them to restore. It's also easier to make sure that they get proper contacts in between, because as you know, it's very difficult to get tight contacts. So that's why I think they wanted to go originally with two implants. The patient was demanding that she wanted three implants, or she wanted four actually, but because she was missing 14, and so they compromised on it. But just from a restorative standpoint, we usually do splinter crowns, which makes sense. So ultimately, we opened up, we removed the superstructure, opened up, and you can see quite clearly that the implant was positioned quite far from the buckle. And then when we flapped it, pictured it, you can see it's almost like a shrinking of bone. So, excuse me, ultimately, we removed that 26 implant, and
bone graft.
No, we just left it because we were going to just leave the case as it is. We went back to the two implants there and the splinter crown. So we cut the third crown off, sent it to the lab to be shaped, and that was it.
But you started out the reasons for that implant.
That's it. So that was what the issue was. So we were worried about that. And the patient was also concerned she didn't have teeth back then. And she was very upset that she couldn't bite on that last mold or whatever it was. So you can see she's got perfect function everywhere else. But she was very worried about it. So she wanted to basically rejig this case. So we sent her off to the oral surgeons who took out the last two implants, and we knew how to do this with it. They did a hip graft, and those are the fixation screws. Yeah, so they took over the hip, that's the iliac crest, and grafted it into place, and placed three implants. And she's just in the process of getting her restoration done. So hopefully we won't have to see her for any type of follow-up surgery.
So look, from the beginning, what was the mistake?
The mistake was that the surgeon basically positioned the implant too far outside the buckle bone housing. They looked at they misinterpreted the CBCT, because you could see by the CBCT that where they were planning to place it, the bone was going to be a tenth of a millimeter thick. So they were taking a risk with it, exactly. And that was where they made the mistake. So that's why I was saying
this.
Sorry.
Right.
No, they did a flap, and it was done. This was probably a poor decision in terms of probably not doing any type of proper bone grafting in that as well. So there were some poor decisions along the way. But that's where, as I say, getting into the planning is oftentimes important.
How many of the complications?
Actually, it took 3 years for the complications.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's the thing. You know, patient went away happy, and then problems came back. But that was likely the problem that, you know, the implants integrated, because 3/4 of the implants were embedded in bone. And even when we took the implant out, it was still solid. But because of the chronic infections that were going on, we couldn't leave it in place. Now, the last thing I'll talk to you about before we take a break is, I don't know, there's a concept that has kind of started to gain a little bit of traction. It's kind of a little bit controversial. Something called a foreign body reaction.
CD4 and CD8?
Not so much CD4, CD8. What we're talking about with this is more so the foreign body giant cell lesions. So there's a thought that was put out by Thomas Albertson, who was one of the fathers of implant dentistry, probably about 2012, 2013, that the way that implants integrate is actually through a foreign body reaction. In essence, the implant is a foreign body, it goes in, the body reacts to it. And in essence, the way that the implant heals, or the host heals the implant, is through a foreign body reaction, the walling off the implant. And so by doing so, if you have maybe some incomplete healing, or you have other factors that will play a role, such as bacteria, etc., that's why you're running into these problems. That the problem is kind of, it's in and of itself just a normal response to healing. Now, as I said, this hasn't gained a lot of traction, but I present it to you just for completeness in case you ever do come across this whole concept. So again, according to classic pathology, chronic inflammatory response is basically the body walls off the implant. And so Albertson basically suggested that this is really just a complication of treatment rather than a disease entity, as we've been alluding to before. So it may be more of a word game than anything. But most implants work because they do achieve a steady state in terms of the bone healing. but then the marginal resorption will happen, and will happen at a varying rate depending on those other factors that we just talked about for the last 45 minutes or so. And so again, you'll get your initial healing, this initial foreign body reaction, this chronic inflammation. And we do know that you need an inflammatory response in order to help with the healing process. What he's suggesting is that there may be some disturbance in that. And this is a slide that they had come up with looking at the giant cell that's characteristic of a foreign body reaction. So it's a giant cell response. So there's different thoughts about that with respect to where the microgap is, and that might there be some biologic issues. But remembering that we don't have, if we go right back to the beginning, we don't have the same attachments. So the biologic width issue, I think, is more, I think it's a controversy. Alberts have basically suggested that there's no evidence of marginal bone loss in periodontitis. You know, what we've been suggesting throughout this is that the bone loss is similar to what we see in periodontitis. But for those of you who have seen the defects that we get in periimplantitis, it's a circumferential defect. We don't necessarily see that in periodontitis. And so, you know, he feels that it was more of a combination of clinician, patient, and implantation factors rather than a disease entity. And again, the chronic inflammatory response may lead to further chronic implications. And again, other factors will lead to further problems. So before we take our break, we'll just kind of come to some conclusions about what we've talked about. And then, as I mentioned, in the second half, we're going to talk a little bit about treatment. So again, the DIRK study that I talked to you about, 4,700 patients were looked at. All implants were restored in 2003. And again, the factors that were evaluated included smoking history, paired disease, systemic disease, recall frequency, implant positioning that. And again, looking at the number of implants that were ultimately lost in the follow-up, the number of patients that actually had smoking as a big risk factor, the shorter implants were a bigger risk factor. There was no difference in terms of the brand of implant that you use. So again, to this day, there's no implant company.
Linking to the diameter.
No, just the short. In terms of, you know, there's no implant brand that seems to be any less. And in my own experience, I've seen all different types of implants that have had problems. So there's not one that is any different than any other. Now, the interesting thing that, you know, if you do go read the consensus report, I'll just put a quote or two at this is what we talked about. This consensus report that came out in 2017, and I do urge you to read this because it does give you at least a pretty good overview in terms of what the current state of mind is with respect to not only perio issues, which you may not be quite as interested in, but more so with respect to peri-implantitis and peri-implantitis. When they looked at smoking, Frank Schwartz was the one that did the review on this particular subject, he found that although smoking, in his review, tended to be quite a significant risk factor in peri-implant mucositis, he actually suggested that there wasn't enough evidence to suggest that it was also a factor in peri-implantitis. Now, I personally find that difficult to believe. I think that to some extent they are a continuum. I think that as more information comes out and better studies come out, I think it will just reinforce that. But again, that shows you the mindset of where we are at this point when it comes to peri-implantitis. We still don't know what's going on.
We don't have a definition.
Well, we don't have a definition. We don't know why. And that's a problem. And yet we're expected to, and that's a problem. We're expected then to deal with it. We don't know why. We don't know what to call it. but we're going to give you some things on how to deal with it afterwards. But I want to just end on a couple of things. This kind of brings us right back to the beginning of what we talked about with respect to peri-implant health. Okay, so again, characteristics of health, and this comes from the 2017 census report. So an absence of erythema or redness, bleeding on gentle probe. Okay, so that is still considered a characteristic of health. Okay, so remember we talked about the bleeding is an issue, but we can get bleeding, but there's no redness, no swelling, no suppuration. Okay, so the difference between implant and periodontal health, the periodontal probing depth are usually deeper around implants than teeth. Pullet implants are usually shorter around teeth, but it's important that it's not possible to define a healthy probing depth around the implant. So again, it's all relative to what your baseline measurement should be. So clinical signs of inflammation, significant bleeding, suppuration, etc. Those are the more important things to be looking for. And again, peri-implant health can exist around implants with reduced bone support. So even after if you've treated a case or you've got a little bit of bone loss, you can still have what can be considered a healthy situation if these other factors are present. And again, healthy implants can have keratinized or non-keratinized tissue. So again, it gets us back to that whole discussion about do you have to have keratinized tissue, not necessarily. So, what are we defining? We're looking for clinically with mucositis, bleeding on gentle probing, plus signs of inflammation, plus an increasing probing depth over time, and obviously plaque accumulation is still the primary. And with implantitis, inflammation and progressive bone loss, plaque and biofilm accumulation, clinical characteristics of suppuration, increased probing depth. Bacteria does not seem to be specific or unique, but again, we're still doing studies on that. Depends on who you talk to when it comes to that. And one of the things that you should realize, though, is that one of the things that was always reiterated is that the progression of peri-implantitis happens a lot faster around implants than it does around teeth. You know, we talk about periodontal disease being a fairly slowly clotting issue.
Because of the left surface.
Yeah, so with respect to implantitis, it usually happens and progresses a lot faster. So it is something that you need to recognize when you're in your recalls. Again, it doesn't mean the patient has to go to surgery on that. We're gonna talk in the second half about you know some of the things that you're gonna do from maintenance to non-surgical therapies as well. But it is something that you need to recognize early on because it can progress out of control.